Thank you very much. The next item of business is a statement by Joe Fitzpatrick on drug deaths. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, 1,264 of our fellow citizens lost their lives to drugs in 2019. That means, on average, every week, 24 families in Scotland are holding funerals for loved ones who have died due to substance use. The scale of the deaths and the wider harms caused by substance use is nothing short of a public health emergency. I have no words that will ease the grief. Nothing I can say can restore loved ones lost to their mothers, fathers, sons or daughters. What I do know is that the stigmatisation does not work. And I think it's fairly clear that the traditional approach to people who use drugs does not work for many. It's imperative that, like with all public health issues, we must follow the evidence. People who use drugs need to be treated with a public health response that prevents harms. Groups who push drugs and bring them into our nation need to be met with the full justice of the criminal justice system. Presiding Officer, the age of people who have died due to substance use has increased over time. The median age of someone who died in today's statistics was 42 in 1999. In 1999, it was 28. In 2019, 68% of deaths were between 35 and 54. The questions are why and what can be done. People in this age group who are long-term users of drugs experience a wide range of social, health and economic inequalities. For many of them, traditional drug treatment and services fail to meet their complex health and social needs. We must change the way in which we provide services and the services themselves in order to provide the vulnerable group with some hope of recovery or, at the very least, death prevention. Changes already being made that will make a difference to this group include the introduction of heroin-assisted treatment, which began in Glasgow last year, and the implementation of our medication-assisted treatment standards, which I will talk more about shortly. At the other end of the age scale, and just as much a concern, is the rise in the number of deaths amongst those in the 15 to 24 age group. This has risen to 76 in 2019, the highest level since 2010. We've also seen an increase in hospital patient stays amongst young people, and we're working with partners, including Crewe and others, to better understand the changing trends and in their drug and alcohol use. Today's report highlights the pressing danger of multiple drug use, or polydrug use. 94% of the deaths in 2019 involved more than one substance. This poses significant challenges to drug treatment services. While this trend is being seen across Europe, in Scotland there is a particularly high prevalence of the harmful use of opiates alongside benzodiazepines, two substances which slow breathing and heart rates, making the risk of death that much greater. One of the most significant rises in death in those related to the use of street benzos is the substance barely featured on our statistics before 2010 are now found in over 60% of fatalities. These are pills that are produced on an industrial scale within Scotland and sold at extremely low prices. Police Scotland are working with domestic and international partners to tackle the issues surrounding pill press machines and their use in the manufacturing of these substances, and I've been calling for the UK government to work with us around the regulation of the sale of these machines, which are readily available over the internet for over a year now. And I'll come back to that point later in my statement. There are also other worrying trends coming through, such as the increasing number of female deaths and the number of deaths relating to the use of cocaine. Presiding Officer, our actions sit under the Rights, Respect and Recovery Strategy and Action Plan. I've accelerated the review of the need and demand for residential rehabilitation services, and the working group leading on this published their report last week. I've accepted the recommendations and committed £90,000 to further progress that work, and that's on top of the £150,000 additional funding already announced for an enhanced offer of residential rehabilitation to people leaving prison during the pandemic to support their recovery. So far, this has supported 8 people with referrals from 4 different prisons, and will carry out an evaluation on people's experiences of using the pathway and what impact this has on their individual recovery journeys in the new year. Early in the new year, I also aim to set out how we will substantially increase the provision of residential services in the short term. Additionally, a project being supported through the Drug Deaths Task Force is targeting directly towards those people most at risk from drug death who have experienced a near-fatal overdose, and providing them with support, combining a community-based response with a residential rehabilitation service, something that has never been tried in Scotland before. Today's statistics in 2019 relate to 2019, and we're now in the end of 2020. This year has seen the Drug Deaths Task Force, which has met throughout the pandemic, take forward a range of recommendations and provide funding to a wide range of projects to reduce harm. In January, the Task Force published a paper setting out 6 key evidence-based strategies for preventing drug-related deaths. Alcohol and Drug Partnerships have reported how they're currently offering or adopting these approaches and indicated where they are proposing to do more. More recently, the Task Force has published a forward plan which sets out how and when it expects its intended actions to make a difference, but it also sets out how they are doing this through the 3 main areas of focus: emergency response, reducing risk, and reducing vulnerability. Under emergency response, the Task Force has been instrumental in bringing about significant changes in the distribution and availability of the overdose reversing drug naloxone. For example, the Scottish Ambulance Service has produced a national programme of take-home naloxone distribution. After a non-fatal overdose, this allows life-saving kits to be given to patients, their peers and family members. And Police Scotland have also announced that they will be running a naloxone pilot in 3 areas. This task force-funded project will begin early next year and will give around 700 police officers the opportunity to administer this life-saving nasal spray if they find themselves in attendance at an overdose. This is a huge step forward and one which I know has taken a significant amount of work to progress. In addition, the task force has provided funding to a range of projects being taken forward by ADPs and other partners to further widen the distribution of naloxone. And evidence shows that fatal overdoses often follow non-fatal overdoses. So the task force has supported several projects to support people after a non-fatal overdose, helping to reduce deaths and increase engagement with alcohol and drug services. In terms of reducing risk, arguably one of the most important areas that the task force has been leading on is the development of standards for medication-assisted treatment. For me, the most important points of these standards are that they place the person right at the centre of the decisions being made about their care and treatment, that they acknowledge the wider issues such as trauma, and that the services should operate a policy of no barriers to treatment. The standards also offer people choice, something which for many has been missing when they've tried to access treatment in the past, be it same-day prescribing, choice of medication, or accessing mental health care at the point of MAT delivery. Furthermore, the standards will provide a level of consistency which hasn't been seen before, moving towards a national approach ensuring a consistent service across Scotland. These standards will also allow clinicians and others to make radical changes to their working practices. There's evidence of this from one of the clinicians who's been involved in the early rollout of the standards. His service had undertaken a test of change to demonstrate the impact on people when working with a low threshold model. This allowed him to support people seeking immediate help, something which he hadn't been able to do previously. As a result of the 35 people who came to his service in the 2 months of the trial, 93% received treatment within 24 hours. Nearly all of them had additional needs, including issues such as food poverty, accessing benefits, homelessness and depression, all of which were able to be addressed at roughly the same time as MAT was initiated, on the day that they came for help. This is welcome progress and something which I hope can be replicated in services all over the country. In terms of reducing vulnerability, the task force identified the need to address the stigmatisation of people and communities affected by drug use. They published a stigma strategy in July, and the members of the task force with lived experience are developing a stigma charter, which organisations and service providers will be asked to sign up to. Furthermore, there is significant work going on to look at drug law reform. Just this morning, a plan was published which sets out how we will explore how changing existing drug legislation could improve access into health and social care services in the event that the Scottish Parliament had the powers to do so. One of the most exciting developments in the last year has been the introduction of the Enhanced Drug Treatment Service in Glasgow, providing injectable diamorphine to those who have been in treatment cycle for a long time. I look forward to hearing more on this in the new year as the service evaluation process completes and we can consider how similar services could be developed to support this most vulnerable group elsewhere in Scotland. Presiding officer, last year also saw the conclusion of one of the most extensive inquiries into drug use and death in Scotland by the Scottish Affairs Committee in Westminster. It was hugely disappointing that all of the major recommendations from the committee, including the need to declare a public health emergency, were rejected by the UK Government. And I'd urge the UK Government to look again at those recommendations, which are based on robust evidence. There are, however, several important issues that UK ministers are engaging constructively with us on. This includes the regulation with appropriate sanctions on the sale and use of pill presses, which could impact on the production of street benzos, which, as I've already mentioned, are implicated in so many deaths in Scotland. And I hope we can take a four nations working on this to achieve this quickly. The last year has also seen us cope with the impact of the worldwide pandemic, and I, along with the Chief Medical Officer, wrote to all health boards at the start of the pandemic to ensure that these essential life-saving services were prioritised. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all those workers and volunteers for their dedication to continue to deliver their essential work throughout this challenging time. Presiding officer, today's figures are the statistical face of heart-wrenching human misery and devastated families. I again offer my condolences to each and every one who has lost a loved one. Other nations have shown that when the approach is changed, the outcome is changed. We have examples that we can follow, and that is what I intend to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in the statement. I intend to allow up to 30 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now, please. And can I call Donald Cameron?
Can I thank the Minister for prior sight of his statement? Today's figures are both stark and heartbreaking, and each death as a result of drugs is an individual tragedy. It's particularly worrying that the number of drug deaths has doubled in Scotland over the last decade, and that Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Lanarkshire, Lothian, Tayside and Ayrshire and Arran health boards account for 3/4 of all drug deaths. I too note with deep concern the rise in the number of deaths amongst the 15 to 24-year-old age group, now at its highest level in a decade. In 2007, there were over 300 residential rehab beds. This number has been cut, and this year, almost half of residential rehab residents have found difficulty in accessing residential rehab and services. We have a world-class rehab facility here in Scotland, Castle Craig, that predominantly cares for Dutch patients when it could also be treating Scottish individuals. Given today's alarming figures, will the SNP government now support calls from drug recovery groups to reverse those bed cuts, and will it create a £20 million Scottish recovery fund? And if not, why not?
Minister.
One of the things that has struck me in the time since I've been in post is speaking to people who use services and those who are in recovery. There is no one silver bullet to dealing with this problem. And I think it's really important that we recognise that. And increasingly, I think, while there are groups of people who say it's really important that we take a harm reduction side, and there are other groups who say it's most important that we support abstinence-based residential rehab, I think increasingly people across Scotland on all sides and are recognise that all of that is true. So I've been clear that from speaking to many people that the journey into residential rehab has been too challenging for many, which is why I asked Dr. David McCartney of LEAP, Lothian Edinburgh Abstinence Project, to head up the working group to look at the different access into residential and other rehabilitation and come up with recommendations about how we can improve that and provide more consistency. He's given some initial recommendations and some statistics, which I would encourage members to read. It's a strong piece of work. I absolutely chose Dr. McCartney because he is a strong proponent of abstinence-based recovery, and I wanted to make sure I got a robust proposal that we can take forward. The working group have recommended some additional work to make sure that we can take this work forward in a robust way that ensures that we have a system that works for everyone. Residential rehab is not an easy solution. It's something that someone has to want to do. It has to be the right thing for the person. There's a relationship between them and the residential facility. But it's clear to me that for many people, the journey into that is too difficult and too challenging in some parts of Scotland. So we'll continue to work with the working group to support their work, and as I said in response to an earlier question from Miles Briggs, that I will come back in the new year with their further recommendations and a proposal as to how we can take their further proposals forward to deliver residential rehab in a more transparent and straightforward fashion in the short term across Scotland.
Monica Lennon.
Presiding Officer, in my topical question earlier on, I said the public must have confidence in the Public Health Minister. Our drug death rate is off the scale. Tonight we'll make the headlines for all the wrong reasons. Today, the Public Health Minister, Joe Fitzpatrick, claimed in a press release that the government is doing everything within its powers. It's simply not true. He should apologise for saying it, and he was given the chance to withdraw the remarks earlier on, but the Minister remains in denial. There is so much to say, but we know that under his watch, residential rehab beds are lying empty. We've got volunteers in Glasgow running an overdose prevention centre out of the back of a van, and the Minister won't even meet with them. They are showing us what courage and bold action actually looks like. And to refer to Miles Briggs, who earlier on said that cross-party, we do want to work with the government, we do want to help and assist the task force. We asked for this over a year ago, Presiding Officer, and the Minister and his chairperson said no, it is disgusting. So if he won't resign and do the right thing, will he at least allow this Parliament to see what the task force is doing and let us sit round that table and find a way forward?
Minister.
I'd encourage members to look at the task force website to see the work that they're doing. I know that the chair of the task force has met from members from across the chamber, and I certainly have. Unfortunately, the last meeting that I had planned with Ms. Lennon, she was unfortunately unable to attend, and I just checked. And as far as I can see, she hasn't managed to ask for a further meeting. But I've tried to engage with members across the chamber as best I can. I can assure Ms. Lennon that the grief that the family and friends of those who have lost loved ones weighs far heavier on my shoulders than the remarks from Ms. Lennon in the chamber today.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Today's figures show an increasing prevalence of benzodiazepines among the mix of drugs that have tragically ended the lives of users. This is a particular concern in rural communities such as Dumfries and Galloway, which has also seen an increased number of drug-related deaths in recent years. Clearly, the availability and use of street benzos is a serious concern. And I recognise the regulation of the kind of machines used in mass production of counterfeit meds is reserved. But however, can the Minister outline what funding has been available to projects to reduce the consumption of so-called street valium, particularly in more rural communities?
Minister.
So the harms associated with these street benzos are hugely concerning, and we can see the numbers, the trajectory of the numbers where the street benzos are referenced in drug deaths increasing. I think one of the things we need to do is to try to remove, to reduce the wide availability. We know that pill presses are one of the issues that means that these pills can actually be produced in our communities and including in the more rural areas. We also know, and so that's why I'm in a very constructive way, I'll say, working with colleagues in the UK government to see whether we can take a four nations approach to legislation, which clearly would be partly around internet, but some of it is about use and regulation, which is therefore devolved to us. So I think a four nations approach is absolutely the best way forward. It is really critical that we find better ways to help support people with those addictions. And one of the streams of work that the medically assisted treatment subgroup of the task force is looking at is in relation to how we help folk with benzos. But I do think that tackling the source of these drugs, which are really sold for pocket money prices and often made within our own communities, is a really important part of that. So I hope we can make progress on that. It's not an easy challenge, and part of what we have to do is to understand why these drugs are being used. One of the other areas that I think we need to make progress on is understanding what is in the drugs. And so one of the proposals coming out of the task force is to look at drug testing facility. Clearly there's issues in relation to licensing around that, which we want to get resolved before the task force moves forward with spending significant amounts of money on that. But I think a pilot which allows for drug testing in a number of parts of Scotland, as being proposed by the drug test task force, potentially could be very, very significant in saving lives.
Brian Whittle, to be followed by Shona Robson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I think we just heard a minister in denial. 10 years since the Christie report, and things have got exponentially worse. Investment in rehabilitation beds, needle exchange programmes, properly funded alcohol and drug partnerships, and a third sector fully funded and integrated with statutory services, as well as special mental health services offered at the same time as addiction treatments. These are all available to the Minister right here, right now. Now, you say you and your government intend to change your approach, and I think the continual failure of policy to date, that is an absolute must. So can I ask the Minister, will the Scottish Government ditch the constitutional football, reverse the cuts and properly invest in solutions that have been called for from the front line for decades?
Minister.
Unfortunately, Mr Whittle clearly wrote his question before listening to my statement. I think I've been very clear to been very careful to not bring the Constitution into this, and I've talked as many times as I can about four nations working together, and I went to extensive efforts to emphasise the positive relationships and where we are managing to work together positively. Clearly there are a couple of areas where I am not satisfied with the collaboration, and I'm continuing to try to progress that as positively as possible. But there are a number of areas where we are collaborating on a four nations basis, but particularly the collaboration between myself and my opposite number, Joe Churchill, who's the public health minister, on a number of areas which I think are of significance in this area. I'd encourage the member to read in detail about the work that the task force has done, particularly around the MAT standards. And I think some of what the member is talking about in terms of services working together, I mean, what it's all about is how we make sure that our services are person-centred and see the person at the centre rather than delivering, and that is what the standards are trying to do, is to change that and to improve that. So that's the work that's going on. So I'd encourage the member to have a good read at that work that a lot of people have put a huge amount of effort into developing those standards to be rolled out across Scotland. I think they should be praised for that. It's all very well for the member to attack me personally, but please have a look at the actual work. Please look at the work that the task force is doing, and you'll give praise where it's due.
Thank you. I'm keen to get as many members in as I can, so can I ask for succinct questions and succinct answers, please, and for due attention to the answers when they're given. Can I call Shona Robson to be followed by Neil Findlay?
Thank you. The Minister said in his statement that we should follow the evidence. So can I ask the Minister to give more information on the outcomes of the really important project working with those who have experienced a near-fatal overdose? And can he also say when the changes to working practices to enable same-day treatment and support for those that are in the trial can be replicated in services across Scotland?
Minister.
So, on the second point, the MAT standards are out for consultation for the second part of the MAT standards, but same-day prescribing is currently being rolled out in ADPs across Scotland. So there's a number of places that have managed to make that change. And I think it is really important because very often when people come for help and support, that's the day that they are ready to make that pretty substantial leap in the change to their life. And so they need the support as quickly as possible at that point. So it's really good. We've seen some really good examples about how that can be done safely. Clearly, there's a risk in terms of prescribing drugs very quickly, but we've seen evidence, particularly of the low-dose regimes making a difference. So that's really important, and I've forgotten the first question the member said, if she could.
Can I call Neil Findlay to be followed by Patrick?
What an absolute disgrace, Presiding Officer, that the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister walked out when this statement started. And for most of the time that it's been on, there hasn't been a Cabinet Minister in the front bench. What a disgrace, and what a woefully inadequate statement from the Minister. We have drug deaths have doubled since 2014.
Please move to your question, please, Mr. Findlay.
It's the Minister who's taking up all the time. 55% cut in drug and alcohol budgets over 10 years. We have 3.5 times a worse situation in Scotland than anywhere else in the UK with the same legislation, Minister. Working class communities are in a crisis, and we see working groups, and we're going to take pill presses off them and think that's going to resolve the issue. Minister, you are a nice man, I believe you are, but we don't need a nice person in charge. We need a competent person in charge. Please stand aside and let somebody drive the change that we need.
Minister.
So, thanks for recognising I'm a nice person. I'm not sure there was particularly a question in that.
I'll call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I share the sense of grief at the figures that have been released, and I wish I could say I was surprised. The decisions on prosecution are fully within the devolved competence of the Scottish Government. Is there not an overwhelming case for saying that Scotland should adopt a principle now that in the absence of other criminal offences, the provision of life-saving health interventions like safer consumption facilities should not be prosecuted, because shutting down those services can never be in the public interest? And if we adopted this principle, wouldn't those services then have the chance to develop to be able to provide a service on the standard that is required?
Minister.
So the member will be aware that prosecution is in the realms of the Lord Advocate and not ministers as such. So I'm sorry, I can't comment on the specifics around that. I certainly believe that in relation to legislation around this, we should have, in general terms, we should have a change of the law to allow actions which could potentially save lives, which are evidence-based, there should be a legal framework for those actions. That is why I've lobbied the UK government on several occasions. I am disappointed that on this matter, there has not been meaningful engagement. I haven't given up because I know that even the UK government's own advisory panel have recommended I've made it clear that there is evidence for this procedure, that these facilities in terms of saving lives, and that the law should be changed. It is a matter for the Lord Advocate as to prosecutorial advice.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. COVID has shown that in a crisis, radical changes can be made in a heartbeat. Well, this too is a pandemic. This is Scotland's hidden pandemic, and it's time for an equivalent response. I know the Scottish Government say they support safe consumption rooms, but I have a straightforward question for the Minister. Does the Minister believe that any individual citizen watching over people, standing ready to intervene to stop them from overdosing and dying, is doing so in the public interest and is providing providing a service to public safety, or does he not?
Minister.
I am very clear that I believe that the law should be changed around these matters. I fear the member is asking me to comment, and he's been very careful about the way he's framing the question, but he's asking me to comment in matters which are relate to a live case. So I think I have to be really careful. I'm sorry. The member knows my views in relation to developing a framework in Scotland to take these sort of facilities forward. I'm really keen that the UK government, if they don't want to change the legislation, then they should devolve those powers to this parliament and let us get on. I think you're right. I think this is a piece of legislation which we would then take forward at a pace within this parliament. Overwhelmingly, I think there is cross-party support. I certainly think on most parties, and I think in Glasgow, where there is a well thought out proposal for a safe an overdose prevention facility, I think there is cross-party support on the council from all parties. So this shouldn't be something that's impossible. I'd call on members from across the chamber to help put just a little bit of pressure on Kit Malthouse, and I think it's possible that we could work together in a way that doesn't result in the UK government losing face or whatever the reason is, but allows us to bring in a policy which the evidence is internationally absolutely clear it will save lives.
Sandra White to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It is a tragedy, so many lives lost and so many families affected. And I don't really sincerely want this to turn into a political bun fight over all of these tragic deaths. It helps no one, and least of all the people who have died and who are suffering from it. I want to pick up on the question from Patrick Harvey and Alex Cole-Hamilton in regards to consumption rooms. We know Peter Cryant has been operating successfully in Glasgow City. He's saved, in my opinion, many lives, and he's supported many people and given them life chances also. The Minister mentioned it's in the hands of the Lord Advocate. Can I ask the Minister, in what way can we in this Parliament bring the Lord Advocate to answer questions as to why he feels it is out with the competence of this Parliament to put forward legislation that we operate safe consumption rules in Scotland?
I would advise all members to bear in mind the rules regarding sub judice and mention of live cases. Minister.
Yeah, just following. I just hope the member will appreciate it. I just cannot comment on this case as it has been reported by the police to the Crown in respect of a criminal charge, and the outcome of that case is not yet final. And as I say again, in policy terms, I strongly support the introduction of medically supervised safe consumption facilities or overdose prevention facilities in order to save lives.
Thank you. I call Annie Wells to be followed by Gail Ross.
Heartbreakingly, today we hear that Scotland's drug death rate is at its highest since records began. Most shamefully, each and every one of these deaths were preventable. As Favour Scotland have already said, one thing is abundantly clear: Scotland's drug services are not fit for purpose. Presiding Officer, setting up task forces and warm words expressed by the Minister today are all well and good, but the simple fact is that actions speak louder than words. Therefore, I am once again asking the SNP Government, when are they going to treat this emergency with the seriousness and urgency it deserves to prevent Scots losing their lives needlessly?
Minister.
Well, I think the member makes several points which I would concur with. This is a public health emergency which we need to treat seriously. We need to treat it in a way that we look at all the options, and ultimately the what's right for one individual needs to be what's right for them at the right time, and that's what we're doing. Obviously, the task force was set up and had its first meeting in the middle of September, so towards the end of this year. But I think when we look at the evidence, we will see a huge number of pieces of work that the task force has taken forward that is saving lives every day, particularly in relation to the emergency response, which is the way to stop someone dying right now. And the evidence is that there is more naloxone now accessible to people who potentially have an overdose at the point of that potential overdose than we've ever seen before. This is definitely a world-leading programme in Scotland, but clearly there's many other things that we have to do as well in terms of getting our harm reduction response right. Part of that is looking at innovative programmes like the heroin-assisted treatment in Glasgow. Part of that is looking at how we make sure that for those people that are a residential rehabilitation route rather than a community rehabilitation route is right, have access to that. And I think particularly one of the works, the pieces of work that the task force is taking forward in relation to combining the benefits of residential rehab with community rehabilitation is one that I'm really looking forward to seeing evidence from that. Because one of the challenges we have is there's a lack of evidence for a lot of these things where, and you go and speak to people and they're absolutely clear that this was the most important thing to their recovery. And I can't ignore that as we fight this public health emergency.
Call Gail Ross to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Iceland has dramatically reduced its substance and alcohol use amongst young people in the last 20 years by adopting a five-step plan. And groups in Caithness are currently piloting a similar model thanks to the funding that's recently been received from the Scottish Government. The Icelandic model is now in operation in 35 cities across Europe. Will the Scottish Government give it serious consideration with a view to implementation in Scotland?
Minister.
Yes, I think the Icelandic model is something that we hopefully across the chamber can all look at very seriously. I was pleased to be able to fund the pilot in Caithness. It's been led by some really amazing people that I had the fortune to meet and discuss this Icelandic model with. I've also attended a couple of events in Dundee where Tessa Parks was looking at the potential for the Icelandic model to be rolled out in a more urban setting, namely in Dundee, and she's going through a project speaking to a number of people about the possibilities and how that might be taken forward. Clearly slightly different dynamics in Dundee compared to most of the places in Iceland, but we also are able to look at how the model has been taken forward in parts of the Republic of Ireland. So I think it certainly is a model that gives us hope for the future. And I really look forward to seeing the outputs from what's going on in Caithness.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
There has still been no recognition in this statement this afternoon so far that Scotland's record on drug deaths is completely out of step with every other nation and region and country in Europe. No recognition whatsoever. Is it not time, Minister, to stop looking elsewhere to solve Scotland's drug death scandal? The safe consumption rooms are part of the answer, and you seem to agree with that. And we've got Peter Kaikran, who faces prosecution for the mobile safe consumption rooms. We already frame prosecution policy on domestic violence and on race. We have the answers within our own powers on the grounds of public health to save lives. Can the Minister tell me why we cannot direct in the frame of public policy prosecution as we already do on race and domestic violence in relation to saving lives when it comes to Scotland's drug scandal?
Minister.
I think we've already talked about why it would be inappropriate for us today to comment on the specific case. And as I say, while it's been reported to the Crown in respect of a criminal charge. In the wider point, I absolutely recognise the challenge that we face in Scotland. This has been some 20 or more years in the making. We can't change it overnight, but we have to make sure that we are working to improve services across Scotland. I am confident that services across Scotland are stepping up and are changing. There's some amazing work going on, some amazing people who are working so hard in this area, but there is no silver bullet. I so wish there was. I so wish there was one thing that you could shout at me and say, if you only did this, then nobody would die tomorrow. If you could do that, then I would find the money. But unfortunately, there is no silver bullet. What we need to do is to look at systems and improve the systems to make sure that everything we're doing is person-centred. We also, as a society, need to make sure that we are knocking down the barriers to support and one of the biggest barriers that we know is stigmatisation and stigmatisation of the treatment for people who have drug use issues.
Stuart McMillan to be followed by James Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I'd like to remind the Chamber that I'm a member of the Management Board of Moving On Inverclyde, a local addiction service. Inverclyde has seen a near 50% increase in drug deaths in 2019, and whilst I note the change of delivery at local authority level, bringing both the alcohol team and the drugs teams together, it's imperative, and that was last year, it's imperative that an increase in rehab use takes place across NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And would the Minister commit to delivering that investment, and also would he agree to meet with local agencies and partners in Inverclyde to learn more about what needs to be done to help those suffering with addictions in Inverclyde?
Minister.
On the last point, the member will be aware, unfortunately, I don't think he was able to join me, as I recall, that I have visited moving houses, particularly moving on, particularly their Safe as Houses project, which is a residential rehab with a community outpost part of that. It's a really good project, really shows integration between that service and the local ADPs. Yes, I'd be keen to come and have another discussion. It's obviously an area that has particular problems that we need to understand, but it's also an area where I've seen good examples of innovative working that is making a difference on the down and on the ground, and certainly speaking to people in those services, they really value the services and they value the huge commitment of the people working in that service.
Finally and briefly, please, James Dornan.
Minister is clearly aware of the good work done by Leap UK and will be aware that there is now a Scottish brand, Leap Scotland. Would the Minister tell me what discussions the Scottish Government have had to date with Leap Scotland, and if none, if they intend to have any in the near future?
Minister.
So, the Lothian and Edinburgh Abstinence Project is one which was originally founded using Scottish Government money. And one of the particularly important parts of that project is it's one of the few residential rehabilitation projects to have a strong evidence base behind it, which is published and peer-reviewed. And so it's because of the incredible work that goes on in that relatively small facility that I asked Dr. David McCartney to lead our work in residential rehab in terms of how we can take that forward to make sure that more people across Scotland have access to that service when they need it, because I think that's one of the crucial points. There may be a time when someone is ready to make that significant contribution, and 2-3 weeks down the road, you know, it might not be the right time anymore. So we need to make sure that these facilities are available to people at the right time, which is why I've asked David McCartney to take on that very important piece of work.
Thank you very much. That concludes questions on the statement. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and across the campus? Can I ask members to observe these measures as they enter and leave the chamber during this afternoon's business? The next item of business.